with us now. He's a research fellow on European security at the Royal United Services Institute. He's a former British Army and NATO officer. Ed, thanks a lot for coming in again. Let's look at the overall picture on the ground at the moment. What is it?
Well, Ukrainian counteroffensive, the rate of advance remains impressive, particularly in the south, but also to the east. And Ukraine has now achieved their primary political objective, which was to show the West that they could use the Western systems, weapon systems that they've been provided to take back territory. They're now pressing ahead more military objectives, which is to liberate as many towns and cities as possible before the winter comes and the contact line goes rather static. But also it's to push the front line forward so that all of the areas in red, which Russia currently holds, would be in range of long-range rocket systems that the Ukrainians have been supplied, so they can degrade Russian ability to prepare for operations next year, starting in March.
OK, let's look at the south, because there are reports that the Russian lines there have collapsed. So have they collapsed? And what would that mean for them if they have?
Yeah, so in the south, it remains the Ukrainian main effort, and they have started to press very much in the west and the north. And really, the Russian front lines have started to collapse and having to move and push back south to try and save their forces. And you can see that there's roughly eight towns and cities that have been liberated just in the past 24 to 48 hours. The issue that the Russians have is when militaries have to withdraw under that type of pressure, they need good commanders to be able to rally, which the Russians just do not have. And also the ground, there's no natural defensive barriers to sort of reset their front lines, as it were. So Ukraine are really trying to push. And the issue is there's no good options for the Russians. They can either collapse back to Kherson, sort of the safety that the city will provide, but ultimately they need to move to the east of the river. I mean, it's 15,000 Russian forces approximately that are on the western side, and it's going to be a real issue in all options that they have, really. You know, it's likely that they will be forced into a surrender by the Ukrainian forces.
OK, so that's in the south. Let's look at the east now. What is the situation there?
Well, in the east, it's not much better for the Russians at the moment. The Ukrainians are continuing with their approach that has worked, which is essentially to push in the northeast and sever all of the ground lines of communication from Russia to Russian forces within the east. Once you sever those lines, the positions for the Russians become untenable. And now a key highway, Highway 66, which is between Svator and Kremina, that is now within Ukrainian artillery range, roughly 30 kilometres. So the Ukrainians are now able to target logistics, which has been an issue for the Russians in the past. And the Russian command and control is not functioning in the east either. You have this odd situation where Wagner mercenaries further to the south around Bakhmut and Donetsk city are actually pressing on offensive operations as the forces in the north on the defensive are being pushed further and further east. So it shows that the entire command and control network of the Russians in the east is just not functioning.
OK, Ed, interesting. Thank you so much. Hopefully see you next hour.